So one day you find yourself in the Army, and you're in the Army. That's, you know, you go in the Army, and you're still the same thing. So you walk around, and then you begin to wonder, well, how did these guys get this? And you see these guys with the things on their shoulders and all that, and you don't know how they got there. How did they know? You know, where did they make the scene? How did this all happen? And it takes you a couple of years to realize, you know, it's funny how kids never question their teachers, really. You know, the teacher's a teacher, and he's, you know, official. The woman teacher's official. And you don't ever go up to the teacher, hey, teacher, how long you study arithmetic? And find out they never studied it at all, you know? You're teaching me arithmetic. What is this? Well, that's the way with the Army. I found out, it was about a year I was in the Army, I found out that most of the guys who were my lieutenants had only been in like in 6 weeks. You know, and it began to dawn on me, what is this? You know, and I found out that they have the IQs of 48, you know. But one thing, they're sharp. They knew, when they went to that place, wherever it was you signed, shoop, they're in the right line. Guess what line Daddy was in? I was in the line that the guy stood up in the front of, the guy, the master sergeant, said, oh, you guys, get in the line over there. That isn't the right line. But that's the line I was in, always. I always wondered how I would see other guys going into these other doors. They never seemed to stand in line. They were always going into doors, you know. They would bend over where they're taking the forms, you know, right. Oh, yeah, of course. The next thing I know, he's leaving the line. He's back going through a door. 10 minutes later, the guy's got things on his shoulders. All I got is holes in my arms from the shots. You know? Oh, yeah, yeah. Wild thing. So I arrive at this camp, and there was a camp in this area that was an absolute hotbed of it, and I didn't really understand it. Because, you see, up to this point, I'd been in a couple of camps where it was like the Army, you know, all the Army. Everybody was getting flayed. Get out there, tot that parlor, and sweating and raining on people and everything. Everybody was in trouble, you know, even the officers, everybody, just rotten. Well, suddenly I arrive at Fort Monmouth, and I did not realize that the Army could be like this. Never let in an outsider. Absolutely. Once an outsider gets in, the whole thing starts to fall down. You know this. It's the truth. A club, you know how it is. So there would be a solid phalanx of these guys with the sharp pressed uniforms, and they all lived in town. In town means on the east side. New Yorkie. Oh, boy. I never saw an entire army that would commute to pads in the village. Well, you know, I never even heard about this before. You know, it was just a complete, and none of these, and all these guys had come from New York and had never been out of New York, which amazed me. And oh, boy, it was everything you see. So these are very official people. Well, they had not only that, not only did they have that. Now every cook who was in the Army there at that place at that time was from the Waldorf or from some fantastic place. I never ate in my life. Like one time, Jack looks at me, like one time I arrived at this camp. It was a funny thing in Monmouth here. And I was used to Army food, you see, and by a fluke of nature, by a specific little thing that I had learned in the Army, a little specialty, I was assigned briefly and very temporarily to this headquarters company. I will not describe. You could not believe the food these guys lived in. To begin with, they had, can you imagine this in the Army? They had a pastry chef in this headquarters company who had been a pastry chef at a very famous hotel in New York. Very famous. This is a pastry chef. I don't mean a guy that made biscuits. So every morning, this guy had one job. He would get up at 4 o'clock in the morning, and he would bake Danish. He would bake Danish and pastry for breakfast for the headquarters company. Oh, it was unbelievable. And this guy would bake Danish and pies. And then, now you haven't heard the rest of it. They had a couple of chefs in the same company who had been meat chefs at the same hotel. So immediately when they came in, they were made master sergeants. You go, they work, you know, go, the colonel wants. So it was the only time I've ever seen guys trying to stow away from all other companies in the area, trying to stow away in the mess line. And they used to watch you. It was like, really, I'm serious, it was like eating every day at the Sherry Netherland or at the Plaza. I'm not kidding you. I mean, it was that quality food. Well, they really had it made, you know, all the way, and I couldn't believe it. Well, among other things, what had happened at this place, at this point, now, I don't know what happened later, this was at this point during the fracas. What had also happened was that a lot of very famous people came there. They didn't want to leave New York. They were writers and things. These guys had they had radio shows going, you know, and they had all kinds of businesses that they were involved in. So, you know, it's very inconvenient to go to a war, you know, give up all that stuff. So these guys wrangled themselves a deal to be at Fort Monmouth. So they would be in the Army, and at the same time, they would be carrying on whatever it was, like, you know, selling their novels, or writing the short stories, or doing the articles for the magazine. It's all right, Ted, I'll do it when it comes to it. Don't worry about it. So these guys had you know, and I couldn't believe it. And another thing, too, about the solid phalanx was that they had worked out a system. You know about the Army, Ted. They had worked out a system of nobody ever saying anything about anybody else. So if certain guys would be absent, say, like 3 or 4 days, nobody would say anything because the other guys had to be absent for 3 or 4 days because their play was opening. I'll tell you, it was an insane scene. It was wild. So I arrived there, you know, and here I am with about 19 other pure A1, 100% privates. And we arrived at this place, and we were assigned very, very briefly to this headquarters company. And it was like suddenly finding yourself in Wonderland. Literally, Wonderland. It was not at all like the Army. And all these guys, they didn't even have fatigues. And they all had tailored uniforms. And they all had cars. And for some reason or other, they seemed to have an unlimited supply of gas. This was during the war, you know. And they had late model automobiles. It was like they were all baby Moss Harts. And the entire New York scene was making it. These guys were making movies, the whole bit out there. Wow. And I said, wowie, you know, and immediately my eyeballs start to shine, little realizing that I was in the outer darkness and never would make it. My Midwestern accent was against me. I didn't know the terrain. I mean, how could I talk about it? Really, no, seriously, you got to have the language to be in. How I didn't even know where 54th Street was in the, you know, how you going to say, you can, you know, Danny's Hideaway, never heard of, you know, what are you going to do about Danny's Hideaway? My idea of coming to New York was to get on the Greyhound and go, if you could possibly do it, was to go to the stage door canteen, get a sandwich, and then get a free ticket to a radio. And if possible, make it, go to Radio City Music Hall and see the Rockettes. That was my idea. Oh, wow, I didn't know. You know, whew, think of what I could have done. Well, anyway, I want to tell you this wild thing that happened one day. I'm very innocent, see. And I had come from this Midwestern place, you know. I'd been in the Army. A lot of guys would be flubbing around. We played softball and things like that when we were taking PT. And so I got no pass at all. And about 5 other guys with me, no pass. We had no passes. They weren't going to let us out. So we're fooling around. And there was a notice on the bulletin board that said, this coming Sunday, the New York Giants are going to be at the field where PT and the parades go on. They're going to be at the great big parade ground at the Ball Diamond on the north end, and they are going to play the post team. Well, I mean, you know, this is better than going down to the service club and playing ping pong. And, you know, and to me, the New York Giants are coming down. You know, to me, the Giants, when you live out in the Midwest, you hear about the Giants and you hear about the Yankees. Honestly, I can't describe it. It's like hearing about Babylon or something. You know, it's just something. They come out of the East, the storied East. They club the Cubs into submission and leave. And, you know, nobody ever thinks about anything. They're not big, you know, just big. So I'm going to see the Giants, Ed. Little did I realize that I was going to meet something that I had never possibly, couldn't possibly have comprehended living in the Midwest, where the closest you ever got to a major league ball player was like the second deck in the Section 28, where once in a while you could holler out, "Hey, Luke! Hey, Luke! Hey, Luke!" That's about as close as I ever got to a ball player. Well, today I am standing on the field and the buses pulled up. I am there early because I figure, you know, there's going to be a crowd of guys show up for this scene. Little did I realize how sophisticated and blasé Fort Monmouth was. So I'm waiting. I figure, you know, 9 o'clock in the morning is not too early for a 2 o'clock game, because I knew that if you were, I better do this. Ted's getting the itch. We've got the Mandarin House here. So we have the Mandarin House. And, hey, one thing I want to make the point very clear about. About 9 of you people have been going to the wrong restaurant. up and writing me. Yeah, I mean, this is terrible. There are about 19 restaurants up in that area, up along Broadway, between 102nd and 103rd, that have the wrong name. These names all sound alike. Be very careful. Between 103rd and 102nd, there is a place called, are you ready? The Great Shanghai. Now, this is also operated by Emily Kuo and is a superb Cantonese Shanghai-style restaurant. And if you dig Shanghai-type food, which is a very special kind of food, I would suggest you try this one. Between 102nd and 103rd on Broadway. Got it? The Great Shanghai. Don't go to the wrong place now. And they get very mad because it didn't turn out the way I said it would. There are about 20 of them around up there, and it's the Great Shanghai. Got it? Okay. Well, now you want to hear old Shep standing on the field there at Monmouth? Let me describe the scene. It is Sunday morning, and there is something very milky and hopeless about Sunday mornings in the Army. If you know how, you know that funny feeling you get at home on Sundays, that feeling of kind of, oh, you know, and the papers are there, and people fool around, and they turn on the television set, and somebody says, let's go for a walk, and all that jazz, you know. And, well, in the Army, there is another element added to it. And it's the element that there is no walk you can go to. It's the element that it isn't even going to start to happen on Monday. See, that's the interesting thing about being a civilian. You always plan for Wednesday, secretly in your mind, that one day a great thing is going to happen to you. Well, in the Army, it's quite the reverse. You plan for a terrible thing that's going to happen to you. Someday, it's going to happen. The worst possible thing, especially when you're in the war. I mean, you don't think in terms of great things happening to you. You think in terms of, well, now, let's see, if I get it in the shoulder, oh, yeah, that's the way guys figure. Yeah, that's a very interesting difference. So anyway, it's Sunday. You got the scene? And it's a kind of a cloudy Sunday, and I am there at 9 o'clock in the morning, waiting anxiously for the buses and all that to arrive, and I figure, you know, it's going to be a real fight to get into those stands. And there I am, and there's about three other guys, all from the Midwest, louts like me. And we're waiting. It's 9 o'clock in the morning. And, you know, getting up on Sunday, that's the only time you can sleep in the Army. And getting up at 9 o'clock, you know, you had to get up at 8 o'clock, get your thing. And nobody fools around the Army. You don't walk around in your T-shirt, you know. You got to get up, you got to shave. You got to put on a shirt, you know, all this jazz, you know. So there I'm all dressed up in my little suitie, and I'm down there waiting and very anxious to see what's going to happen. The New York Giants are coming. Well, we wait. And another guy joins us from Minnesota or someplace. And we wait. It is now 11 o'clock, and we're sitting in the wooden stands. They have little wooden stands, little tiny ones, you know, like they have at Little League games. A little wooden stand, say, and it's now 10 o'clock, and finally it's 10:30, and next it's 11 o'clock, and it's 11:30, and it goes on and on and on. And then I see pulling up back around the rear where they have the long sheds where they keep tractors and stuff. I see this big gray bus pull up. It's an Army bus. It's a U.S. Army. It pulls up there. We look, and sure enough, a lot of guys get out, a whole bunch of guys. You say, wow, you know, whoo, and we're watching, and about 30 guys get out of the bus, and we're looking out, you know, we're all excited, and sure enough, they begin to drift over one by one, and they're looking around, they're fooling, and then they get back in the bus, and they go away. Yeah, we're very excited now. That was them, the New York Giants, because they were in civilian clothes, see, it's the Giants, whoo, and we're waiting very excitedly. Now it is noon. It's getting a little warm, you see. It's now 12:30. Somebody runs down to the PX and gets us a bunch of Milky Way bars, and we're holding a seat. There's nobody else has arrived yet. You see, it's all four of us. We're holding the seats there. See, don't. Now, if they start coming, you're home. I'm sitting here, you see. I don't care if it is a master sergeant. Hit them. I'm sitting. I've been here since tomorrow. Here, I'll leave my cap. No, better not leave. I'll leave my shoe here. There, my shoe. That was that kind of a scene. We're waiting excitedly. Well, to make a long story even more dismal, roughly about 1 o'clock, there are now about 25 guys in the stands, a scattering of guys. And sure enough, the bus arrives back. Apparently they have taken them somewhere where the officers eat and have fed these guys or something. And now they get out of the bus, Eddie, and they are wearing baseball suits. Yep, they have dressed, and they got real base. And they're the Giants. It says Giants. They got the white uniforms, you know, with the blue hats. And why are they? And it's the Giants. And there's 20 of us, you know, all from the Midwest. And these guys come running out on the field, you know, they're throwing around, they're fooling around. And of course, we're looking. We don't know what to say. You know, wow. And there's a first baseman where I'm sitting on the first baseline. There's a guy about 9 feet away from me. He's the first baseman of the Giants. And they're tossing the ball back and forth, these guys, whipping it around. And you know, we don't know who the post team is. You say, who's the post team? You know, we never heard about a post team. You know, the post team. And about 10 minutes later, a big army bus arrives. And you should have seen it. A bunch of guys get out who were at least 12 and a half feet tall. Out of our... And they got suits on. And it says on the front of them, Monmouth. These guys are monsters. And they get out, you know. And what happens? We can't believe it. They're walking out on the field, you know. And they all know each other. Hey, Phil, for crying out loud. Hey, Phil. Oh. And they're hitting each other and shaking and yelling. And I can't, what kind of, a, you know, who are these guys? These guys who are supposed to be us. They're representing us. And they know, the first baseman is a guy named Phil Weintraub. Any of you ever hear of Phil Weintraub? He was right in front of me. He was playing first base for the wartime Giants, I will tell you. Weintraub is hitting this guy in the back, and they're yelling at each other. And Bill Jurgis is playing shortstop for the wartime Giants. Famous shortstop, and he's yelling and hollering at all these soldiers. I thought, for crying out loud, what is this? Wow. And by this time, the fans, you know, begin to show up, and about 10 minutes before game time, there's about 100 guys, 20 of which are from Midwest, all sitting awed, and the other 60 guys are hippies from New York who know every one of these guys. Hey, Phil! Oh, for crying out loud! Manny! Oh, and they're hitting each other. They're all friends, you know. I don't know, what is it? And I'm watching the big league ballgame. Well, to make the long story even sadder, the first inning goes this way. The New York Giant pitcher is out there. Little did I realize I was watching wartime baseball. He winds up, and the first one of the Fort Monmouth soldiers belts a ball about 590 feet. Pow! And he tears around second, tears into third, comes across that home plate without even breathing hard. Little did I realize that almost every one of the Giants, the real New York Giants, were at Monmouth. And our pitcher was a man named Darius Musso. Did you ever hear of Musso, who pitched with the Yankees, belts balls for miles? It was an in-group and an in-group and an in-group and an in-group. There will be a